So how do we value? How do we value a stock? What are some things that we'd use to value a stock? How much it's worth? That's kind of what we're trying to do. So the stock price plays a role, right? So that's kind of what we're trying to do is come up with the value of the stock. So, valuing a stock. So, we're trying to come up with the value, which is the price per share. We can go to the Wall Street Journal, and it says Apple is going to be $107 a share. So, do we buy it or do we not buy it? Buy it or not buy it? Yeah, so what are we going to determine by overvalue, undervalue? Okay, so let's list some of that stuff. So what's our required rate of return? Okay, what else? If they're in debt, so company debt. What else? Expected future earnings. Okay.
Dividends.
Dividends, yes. Now, how does a dividend differ from expected future earnings? Or does it? How does a dividend differ from expected future earnings?
Not all shares pay out dividends.
Okay, not all shares pay out dividends, right? So we have dividend paying stock. So what is a dividend? Is it a share of earnings? Is a dividend a share of earnings? It's a share, right? A fractional share, but it's related to earnings, right? So how does a dividend differ from earnings? Whether it's expected future earnings or maybe actual earnings. What's the difference between the dividend and that? Some of you I know have had some stock valuation courses, maybe with Dr. Moore. Was that last semester with valuation and stuff? What's the difference there between a dividend and the earnings or expected future earnings? Okay, dividends are a percentage of the earnings. Good, so they can be a fraction of it. It could be committed to kind of contractually or in some of the company books, or it could be done differently just as a fractional amount. And so earnings might go up or down, but some companies might choose to continually pay out a dividend, which means the fraction of earnings that the dividend represents can float around, right? See the difference? So on a dividend is an amount paid depending on your ownership in stock, amount that's going to be returned to you. Whereas earnings are not necessarily returned to the owners. They can be reinvested or kind of have retained earnings. So earnings profit basically that sits in an account because maybe they're thinking about doing a big addition and they need some money to fund that, right? So there's lots of activities of the company. The dividend's kind of a big deal because the company is getting rid of money. They're paying back their owners with no expectation that those owners are going to turn around and put that back into the company, right? It's gone. We can't use it for growth. We can't use it to have an increase in pay if we want for our employees. I mean, we are letting loose of that money. So a lot of companies do not pay dividends, as somebody mentioned. I can't remember who's that, but not every company pays a dividend. In fact, most companies probably don't pay dividends. So there's dividend stocks, and then there's stocks that don't pay dividends. All right, so certainly that is important, though, in the value of the stock is, does the company pay a dividend? And then ultimately, we can start thinking about the actual company itself with some of those underlying fundamentals, company debt, expected future earnings. All right, so these are some of the things that'll go into our valuation of the stock. So the value that I think it's going to be today is equal to what? How do I maybe take some of this into account and this? If I'm only interested in holding this thing for 1 year, we can think about Kimmy's required rate of return thing. What do I want to think about in kind of really basic terms about what I think it's valued at today? How do I make money? We already mentioned the dividend. So how do I make money? Dividend is that they're paying part of it. I buy a share, I get some amount of a dividend. Yeah, the value as the stock rises. So what the value is tomorrow when I sell it. So really, when it all boils down to how do I make money, it comes down to what did you pay today? What are you going to get tomorrow? And is there any dividend in between? Right? So we're really down to dividend and future price. So that's kind of what we want to think about. And this is true of my more general discussion that we had in money and banking and I think some other class. Well, I do it in personal finance a little bit, about any type of investment, right? If you buy a classic car, you bought the car today for $10,000. You hold it for some period of time, 1, 2, 3, 4 years. You're hoping that that sucker is going to sell for something higher. Over the course of the year, you had to do some improvements to the car. You spent some money on gas and upkeep and car shows. You spent $200. And then maybe you won a prize at the car show here in Ottawa, and it was a $500 prize, right? So that car, if we think about the car as an investment, had a cash flow associated with it. All investments, I argue, have these three components. The initial investment, what you were out today, your operating flows, and then finally, your terminal cash flow. And then we're just down to a present value calculation. Here's what I was out, here's what happened over time, here's what happened at the end, calculate the present value of it. What's the present value? Present value is the future value divided by 1 plus the interest rate raised to the n power. That's our basic single period model, right? So if this is the cash flow or the future value in year n, so if this is year 5, what's the present value today of something I'm going to get 5 years from now? But if you get multiple flows, then it's the sum of each one. You got to treat individually. So if it's a present value of a cash flow stream, you got to take the future value in time period 1 divided by 1 plus I raised to the 1 power plus the future value in time period 2 divided by 1 plus I to the 2 power plus the future value in time period n raised to the n power. Right back to foundations of finance class, right? Our present value, future value. So this is the present value of a future income stream. We just do this all the time to different types of investments. If it's a stock, I bought it in time period 0, I had dividends over the next 4 years, and I ultimately sold it. And we just calculate what's that worth to you. Where it gets interesting is what this chapter is going to talk about is form expectations about what the future is going to look like. Where do those come from? How do we do it? How does it apply specifically to financial markets in this chapter? All right, so we could characterize that if we had a constant dividend, I kind of did this part already. Let's do this one. All right, so the sum of dt, did they do a t? I printed this so small. The sum of dt divided by 1 plus k e, which is Kimmy's required return raised to the t power for t equals 1 to infinity. We go to infinity if we start thinking about, I don't have a known time period I'm going to hold. So all I know is I'm going to collect the dividend for forever. And so that's one way to determine the value of the stock if we don't have a sales price in mind. Okay, so questions on that? Otherwise, we're doing this with dividend, 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 and then finally our sale price at the end. But again, we don't know what that sale price is going to be. All right, so using those concepts, Paige, just so you know, we're in the other room, but the technology failed us today, so I still have you on a laptop that I'll try to keep. If I start yapping and it's not really tracking, speak up, and I'll try to move it, okay?
Okay, thank you.
All right, so the first model we're going to look at is called the Gordon Growth Model, which is kind of a basic valuation tool. The Gordon Growth Model. And if we have this idea of running dividends out to infinity, there's some math that the book will show you that'll break down a simplified formula. And so that's part of what we're going to look at here. If the price has a dividend that's expected to grow, so let me actually, before I do this, let me define some variables here. So let D0 be equal to the most recent dividend. The most recent dividend paid, D0. G, little g, is the expected constant growth rate. The expected constant growth rate in dividends. KE is the required return. The required return on an investment in equity. The required return on an investment in equity. So that's the word we're using for stocks, right? Bonds are, in contrast, bonds are debt. Stocks are equity. And we are going to have a different required return on that due to what? What's one of our main factors that would cause us to have a different required return for equities as we do for bonds? What is it?
Risk.
So risk differentials between the two. So we're just kind of clarifying that just because you think you need to get 10% return on equities doesn't mean you need to get a 10% return on bonds because of the risk differential. So we're thinking about the type of asset that we're investing in. Okay, so the key here in using this Gordon Growth Model for estimating value is that dividends dividends are assumed, I've got to be careful of our assumptions, assumed to grow at a constant rate G forever. It's just an assumption on a model, likely, probably not, but for this evaluation, that's what we're doing. And furthermore, G is less than our required return, KE. The dividend growth rate is less than what our required return rate is. For hopefully reasons that'll be obvious once we get it up there. All right, so the math of all this present value stuff turns out to simplify down to this formula.
Hey, Russ.
Yes? Oh, thank you.
Underneath G, is it K-E or R-E?
K, little okay. K. Yep, I got the little scribbly K.
Thanks.
Okay, so the price is equal to the original dividend paid times 1 plus G divided by K-E minus G. So this is the required return minus the growth rate and dividends. So that differential, and then it's the current dividend being paid times 1 plus G. All of that turns out to be a mathematical masturbation of the equation, taking this, using some fancy math, and I'm not kidding, this would be for a math class. That's why in this class we pretty much say, trust me, trust the math people. They can turn this concept into this little simple equation, okay? Questions on that? I think your book shows a little bit of a proof on it, so those of you who want to do the geeking out on the math, it's all yours. Okay, so then your book does this one simplification and calls this D1. So that the Gordon growth model reduces down to that expression, where D1 is just the step up here, your next period's dividend. All right, so now, what does this say about how prices and values will change? So if the required return goes up, if there's an increase in our required return, I need to get not 10%, 12%. So if my required return, is everybody comfortable on the required return business? What determines your required return? What's that? You do. Determined by what, according to you? So just dig down a little bit deeper for Matt or somebody wants to add on, because you're right, you determine it based on what you're willing to risk. Based on, that's the buzzword I was looking for. There's the econ buzzword. A little louder, Kayla. Opportunity cost. What else could you be doing with your money, right? So you've kind of weighed out all the alternatives, taking risk into account, and you determine that required return. Okay, so if that required return has gone up for you, what happens to the value? Let the math speak to you this time. Down, right? So if this gets bigger, the denominator gets bigger, the overall expression gets smaller. And so now that stock isn't worth as much to you. There's a decrease in value. Okay. All right, so that's a little bit on the Gordon growth model. So a couple of notes from financial crisis. All right, so decrease in growth prospects. A decrease in G. So we start to see the financial sector struggling. And we start to revise our G downward. What happens to our values? G goes down. So let's start upstairs. G goes down, numerator gets smaller, causing the expression smaller. G gets smaller, denominator gets bigger, causing the overall expression to get smaller, driving prices down. So when we start to see expectations change on the growth rates and dividends, that's going to put downward pressure on the stock prices. So a decrease in growth prospects leads to a decrease in prices, value. All right. Did something like the financial crisis cause more uncertainty or less uncertainty? More uncertainty or less uncertainty? More. More risk or less risk? More. So more required return or less required return? More. So we got the same thing going up here with this pressure from the financial crisis, an increase in uncertainty leads to an increase in the required return, leading to a decrease in values. All right. Questions there? Simple model has its drawbacks, not perfect. Especially when companies don't have dividends, then this one doesn't apply quite as much, right? So this is one model that can be used to estimate values. So sometimes, especially in a growth or in a dividend stock environment, you could apply the prediction of the Gordon values by plugging in all of these for all the stocks that you have. Then you go to the Wall Street Journal. This stock is, we got four stocks, A, B, C, and D. The Gordon growth model predicts that the value, according to me, is these values. Wall Street Journal says these values. Have a little Excel spreadsheet. If this value exceeds the Wall Street Journal's price, it's a buy signal. If it doesn't, it's a sell signal. So you can use the Gordon growth model to say, which stock should I buy, which one should I sell? And you just go down the list, okay? That's the idea of it. All right, so rational expectations is our next topic. Rational expectations. All right, so expectations are said to be rational if we have a forecast based on all available information. A forecast based on all available information. So we've squeezed out all the information we can, which means that a rational expectation should be correct on average. So this is what we should observe. A fancy way of saying that is that the error terms sum to zero. We have an equal chance of overestimating or underestimating would be another way of thinking about that. We got equal odds of over and underestimating what our forecast is. So maybe my commute time to Lawrence from Ottawa is 25 minutes, plus or minus 2 minutes. And I have an equal chance of being high two, that it actually took me 27 minutes, or I have an equal chance of it taking or going a little quicker, right? But on average, depending on what the traffic flow is, things that I can't predict, circumstances that I don't know about, maybe it's weather related or something else, that I have equal odds of being plus or minus a certain amount, but there's no way to know that information. So I've got this result from a rational expectation of being correct on average. All right, so that's kind of a big nut to crack. What does it look like? So before I kind of get into the rational expectations, I'm going to put recall, but I can't be sure that all of you have seen this. Recall adaptive expectations. Adaptive expectations. Does anybody remember what those are? I mean, I think I probably covered that in Principles of Macro really, really briefly. You might have seen it in some other classes. Adaptive expectations. My expectations are adaptive. I think you can kind of, what am I relying on for adaptive expectations?
Pretty flexible.
Not really, actually, in a sense. Because of my expectations of what's going to happen next period, they're actually kind of inflexible. There is some flexibility. I'm wiggling around a little bit on that. So if Apple's price 5 days ago was $107, 4 days ago was $107, 3 days ago it was $107, 2 days ago it was $107, 1 day ago it was $107, today it's $107. What's my prediction of what it's going to be tomorrow? 107. Using adaptive expectations. What's that? What did it look like the previous 5 days? Right? I'm going to base my prediction on historical things only, like what happened in the past with the price. So the reason why I wiggled around that, Jacob, a little bit was you can look at adaptive expectations like, do I look 5 days back or 10 days back, right? So maybe there was a little fluctuation 10 days ago. Do I go 20 days back? And am I averaging it? Am I doing some sort of regression? Or, you know, what am I doing to come up with that? But the main thing is, it's a forecast that's based on history only. So we're always kind of working backwards. We're adapting our future based on the past. So an expectation formed from past experience only. So the examples of this would be like a moving average.
You forgot me.
Oops, thank you. An example would be a moving average, where you average the last 5 days, right? So tomorrow equals average last 5 days. What I predict is going to happen tomorrow is the average of the last 5 days. In my example, I did 5 days at 107, average those, it equals 107. But maybe it went from 108 to 105 to 107. You know, there's some different numbers. I just take the average of the last 5 days. That's called a moving average of that stock price. A simple one would be today's price equals tomorrow. You want my best guess for Apple stock? What is it today? Not the last 5 days moving average, but what is it today? If it's 107 today, I predict it's going to be 107 tomorrow. Even though the last 5 days might have averaged 106.5, I think it's better to use today's price for tomorrow's price, right? So it's just looking at history that way. All right, so I kind of want to give you the punchline to the story before we get into some of the details. So the punchline to rational expectations theory is that there's no way you can make a buck in the stock market. That's kind of the punchline. There's no way to consistently turn a buck in the stock market. The price that we see today, if we went live to the Wall Street Journal and it said 107 for Apple stock, there's no way for you to profit off of that in the next time period, like tomorrow. It is literally equal odds of being a little higher, a little lower. That price is efficient. That price captures all available information. So all of the people on Wall Street are doing meaningless jobs. It's kind of part of it. None of those guys could outperform maybe a coin flip. That's really what's argued with this theory, is that the markets are efficient. And so you truly are, in the short term, kind of gambling. In the long term, we see growth in stocks and the values of companies. So there's good evidence to say that on average, all companies grow by 10% per year over a longer time period. And so the best thing to do is to own a whole bunch of companies and guarantee yourself the 10%. But nobody, including Warren Buffett, by the way, has been able to systematically beat the market, right? Nobody's been able to systematically beat the market. If the average market has been 10%, there's not a stock picker out there that has been able to beat the 10% on a regular basis. Now, Warren Buffett is the guru of this investing because for a long period of time, he was consistently above the market. And there's some interesting history on that with value investing. And I think he was taking a different approach to valuing companies than other people were at the time. But I went to the annual meeting. A couple of you guys have gone to that too, right? Where with Dr. Moore, you went. Did anybody else in here go? Yeah. So Berkshire Hathaway is their company, and they have this annual meeting that's kind of famous. And I got to go like 4 years ago. And even Warren Buffett himself said that his competitive advantage really doesn't exist any longer. It essentially got competed away. The value that he brought with how he picked stocks was eventually learned by a whole bunch of other stock pickers. And so the edge was gone. The competitive edge disappeared, which is a lot of what we talk about in economics, that competitive edges, or those angles that you have, that special niche that you have, eventually gets copied or recreated and competed away so that you're just earning a normal profit. And so Warren's edge that he said they still have is that they've got piles of money, billions of money that nobody else has. And so this was an interesting angle that I've read further on it at different times. When the market takes a tank and everybody's running for cash, they still have a big stockpile of cash. So they're really fat, they're cash rich. And that gives them the opportunity to buy big companies. So big company, if you've got a $3 billion company doing a fair valuation based on some sort of analysis like this, but the general economy takes a downturn and your $3 billion company is now only worth $1 billion, and it's a steal at $1 billion, you have to find somebody with $1 billion to buy it. Warren Buffett's got that $1 billion, right? So he can buy that good deal because of his purchasing power. That's what he argues is kind of their last competitive edge, because a lot of people are doing the fancy modeling and computer trading and you name it. All of that stuff is out there. So the punchline for rational expectations is that nobody out there can beat the market on a consistent basis. And so you're kind of beating your head against the wall to try and do so. And you're better off just putting it into the general market on average. All right, now some of you have taken some stock classes and other things. Any comments back on that? Can we turn a buck in the short term? You know, some people challenge that there's still information to be had day by day, combing through the data, looking for new companies, new information pops up and you act on it, maybe you can turn a buck. But you have to do a lot of work for that. And so once you factor in your opportunity cost, it's maybe arguable about whether it was worth it or not. All right, so that's the punchline. So here is, let's see. This is really the same math. All right, let's see. Let's start here. Okay, actually, let me go ahead and put the punchline down. The punchline. Rational expectations is also in financial world called the efficient market hypothesis. The efficient market hypothesis. And it basically, the punchline is you can't beat the general market consistently over time, because the current prices reflect all available information. parentheses, rational expectations. And then I don't want to reiterate what I already did here. That means we're correct on average, and it's coin flip. Odds are you're either going to win or you're going to lose. And it's just going to be what it's going to be. Have some of you read or heard A Random Walk Down Wall Street? It's a fairly famous book. I think it was put out in the late 80s, but I know a lot of finance professors, I know on Dr. Moore's reading list, I don't know if he assigned it for any of your classes, but it was essentially going through this concept that it's a random event for some people to be above the market than others in a given year. All right, so R, I'll define these in a second. Let me write this one out first. The rate of return on a price on a one period stock is PT plus one minus PT divided by PT. And then we can add a little C in there, which like was our coupon payment with a bond, but more generally just a dividend or some sort of cash payment. So this is true for bonds or stocks. So R is the rate of return.
You forgot me again.
Oh, thank you. So R is the rate of return. PT plus one is price in time T plus one. PT is the price today, price in time T. So if it's 2015, 2016, so a 1 year jump. Since it's just 1 year, we're just gonna throw that dividend. Possible that the dividend or the coupon payment was zero, so C is some sort of cash payment during the time period. So it could be a dividend or a coupon if we're talking about a bond. So this is kind of generic either way. So then we can easily turn this into expected returns by putting the little E on it and realizing the only thing we don't know potentially is T plus one. And now this turns into our expected return equation. We know what the price is today. We know there's a dividend or a coupon payment. What's it going to be worth after 1 year? And this is now just the expected return. Okay, we'll kind of tie a few things together and then we're going to do a worksheet on Friday to see how well this stuff is gelling in. So we'll work some equations, make sure you're on the right track. See you Friday.
Thank you.
Yep, bye.
Bye.
What?